Ladies and gentlemen, nerds and neckbeards.
Nerds and neckbeards.
Welcome to another edition of
Westeros
Whenever-ly. 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 Tana.
Hey, Dave.
It's been a while.
It's been a minute.
But you know what? I think it was well worth the wait because finally.
Here we are.
We are going to be talking about.
Of all things.
The Citadel.
The Citadel. The Citadel. The Citadel.
I know Tana's been kind of like teasing everyone with it, and every week so far.
We've been building. I mean, there's a lot to. You have to understand this whole region, really.
Yeah, it's a big deal.
I'm looking a little low.
You need to make sure that you talk.
Am I talking into my microphone?
Into the microphone. Tana.
Oh, that'll do it.
There you go.
Hey, oh. Guys. Hey, nice to be with you. It's so nice to be with you guys now so you can hear me.
All right. Excellent. All right. So.
Always a little rusty around the edges. Hey, yeah.
All men must drink. That's right. Let's start off by telling everyone what we're drinking tonight.
Well, first we had an amazing shot.
Which was ridiculously unexpected.
It was smooth like green marble.
Oh my god. But it is actually a green... What did we call
Sphinx.
It? A green Sphinx.
Yeah.
So, I'll tell you what it is because I just basically went into my pantry and said, I have this. So, it was about... what would you say that top thing is about 1 ounce?
I would say about 1 ounce, yeah.
All right, so it's about 1 ounce Blue Curacao.
All right, naturally.
Naturally.
Because I came over and I was like, Dave, what shot are we doing tonight? Surprise, I don't have a shot planned. Play along. And so he's like, I don't have any booze. Let me go see what I have in the cabinet. Which is what brought us to this amazing shot that we just did that we thought was going to be gross, but it turns out it's actually pretty amazing.
Yeah, it was
smooth,
super
man.
Surprised at how smooth it was.
It was a smooth little bandit.
So it's about 1 ounce of Blue Curacao.
Naturally.
1 ounce of Wild Turkey.
Yeah, and which is a bourbon. Is it a whiskey?
It's a whiskey, I think.
Okay. And all then, bourbon is whiskey, but not all whiskeys are bourbon. Is that right?
I have no idea.
Okay, well.
You're talking to someone who just drinks.
That's true. In any case.
Okay, so 1 ounce of Blue Curacao.
Yeah.
1 ounce of Wild Turkey.
Mm-hmm.
And then about a 1/2 ounce-ish of Disarrono.
Disarrono, which is...
Which, if you are me, you have it from the last time Tana brought it over in a mini 8 ounce water bottle.
Like a tiny, it's like a 6 ounce, like whatever the mini water bottles
are. Yeah,
it was
like a baby water bottle.
Like a bite-sized water bottle that I put the booze in because I was like, oh, and I think the one that you have, I wrote on it with a Sharpie. And I scratched out, like I've done this a million times because I'm a cheap bastard. And so I wrote, I think, gin on it and then scratched it out. And on the other side wrote Disarrono.
Yep.
So that was still in your cupboard.
It was still in my cupboard. Probably from over a year ago.
From the show. Not finale. What's the opposite? Premiere.
The premiere. Oh, was it the premiere?
Yeah, because isn't that when we did strawberry cups?
Yeah, because you made, like chocolate strawberry cups.
And
that's
the trick
right.
was, and I hadn't realized this at the time, which now looking back, duh, I should have just iced the Disarrono, but instead I put just like room temperature Disarrono into the fruit cups, and it was like, it had a sort of like stinging quality to it. And once I iced that down, you guys were like, oh, we're into this. So that's where that came from, if memory serves.
Yeah. I think that was a year ago.
Yeah.
Almost exactly.
Near enough. Dave, we've been at this a while, buddy.
Oh, man.
You are looking like Bobby fucking Baratheon right now. I know this is an audio podcast, but you guys, Dave has a luscious beard going on. Like, it is, it's not, it's full, man. You can grow a beard.
That
thing is, it's meaty.
Imagine a bush.
That thing.
But on my face.
It's bushy, man. Like, that thing, it's changed your whole face.
Do I look fatter now?
No, you look more distinguished.
Oh, yeah?
Somehow, yeah. Okay. Now,
so I don't need like gray in here or anything.
Oh, no. I think that you have a nice like that is it's you look like Bobby Baratheon, man.
All right, give me a warhammer
like,
and I'm
it.
Done.
You need a warhammer and to start singing the Bear and the Maiden Fair.
Now all I need to do is have my brother go fall in love with someone and then have the prince run off with her.
Is your real life brother a Stannis? Or a Renly?
He's He's a Renly.
He's a Renly. He's a Renly. Oh, he's the copper or bronze. Copper, whatever it is.
Yeah, he's definitely a Renly. Yeah. Sorry, Andrew. You are.
Just... to Andrew. To the Andrew. Renly of the Renly of the family.
Is your brother a Renly or a Stannis?
I have two brothers, and
is one a Stannis and one a Renly? Because that would work out great.
It would work out great, but no, neither of them is a Stannis. I think Stannis is kind of a rare guy. I don't see too many unbending, you know, super brittle.
Willing to burn his own daughter.
Like, that's the thing. Like, Stannis is an outlier. I love Stannis. It's
I know. But, like, our third episode was Stannis still has a chance.
Yeah, and but both my brothers are more Renly. They're a little less substance. Sorry, Pat. Anyway, and for the drink tonight, because we are doing Old Town. We're still in Old Town. This will be our third episode, so this is the third.
We're hanging out in the Quill and Tankard.
That's right.
Yeah.
On our little island, you and I are just having some strong ciders. We ordered a nice charcuterie plate.
That's right.
From Rosie. No, is that... Rosie? Sure. Is it on the island?
Let's go with Rosie.
When Alaras and Feast for Crows, when they go to the island and the alchemist is going to give the... Is that on Cider Island? Is that at the Quill and Tankard?
I think they just say the island, right?
I don't know. I don't remember, but let's pretend we're there. Okay, so that's where we are tonight.
All right.
We're at the opening of Feast for Crows.
Serving wench!
Yes!
Bring me more cider!
It's Rosie. If we can rustle up a golden dragon tonight, her maidenhead is ours. That's the deal, right? That's Pate. He needs his dragon. That's why the alchemist gives him a
dragon.
I don't
know how I feel about taking a maidenhead.
I'm not saying that. I'm not.
I know that's what you just said.
I know that's what I just said. I'm saying, so, I'm trying to orient us in the story. That's the plot point. So you're not trying to take
no maidenhead tonight.
I'm actually not. Also, there's a theory that Jaqen was working with Rosie and sort of like whored her out, like made it. Like said, this is how you. He needed to get Pate.
Do you think that
so he employed Rosie to say, "Oh, maidenhead for a dollar for a golden dragon"?
Do you think that? I know this is completely off topic, but this just brought
me to it.
We're not
into topic yet.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, that's a good point.
Yeah.
So, if you are a faceless man or woman,
sure.
Can you make yourself a virgin again? Can you give yourself a maidenhead again?
I feel like these guys are pretty magical, right? Like, they're steeped in magic, aren't they? So there's a spectrum. And on one end of the spectrum, in all religions, you have the seven, which have shown no magical ability whatsoever, right? So the theory with the Citadel, lame. Like, they don't have any magic. Nobody comes back from the dead. Nobody lives extra long lives. There's no... It's just like, it's the common religion, but it's boring as fuck. You've got the drowned god. People come back from being drowned.
So on the magical spectrum,
the seven
is like the shitters. Yeah. They're like stupid. They don't got nothing.
Okay. And then on the other end, what do we have?
Red Velour.
They're pretty magical. Yeah. People actually come back from the dead with Red Velour, and you get shadow babies and shit.
Yeah, what? You get like a shadow demon?
Yep. So that's definitely on the other end of the spectrum. But
do you think that's all the way to the other end? I mean, the faceless men can completely change their face.
We also have the old gods, right? And we think that the others were created.
And the weirwoods and others. Yeah, that's...
And so they have a resurrection business. And they can talk to animals. And they can warg, right? And they have all the nature magic.
That's...
So anyway,
so it's almost as if all the
So where do you think the faceless men, if there's a continuum, yeah, where are they?
I mean, they got to be somewhere in the middle, right? They seem to be, they're able to change their faces, but they don't kill people by throwing magic spells at them, right? So they're not
demon
like
babies. They birth out of shadow and life force or whatever.
Yeah, they're not doing that like Red Velour. So
they're
not
hatching dragons.
No, they're definitely maybe we don't know.
Right. What is Jaqen doing there? Again, we're getting ahead of ourselves.
Anyway, let's rewind a little bit. This episode is about the Citadel. We're sitting in the Quill and Tankard.
Hey, Dave.
With
nice
Rosie.
To meet you
nice
here
to meet you,
in this
Tana.
Loud
yeah.
bar, Quill and Tankard. Yeah. Oh, look at all these annoying novices around here.
Yeah, screw these people. We got charcuteries and strong cider.
That's right. Rosie, bring us another.
Rosie, no maidenheads.
This
here.
Is how we got started on it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, right. Good point.
Okay. So,
let's get into the episode.
Let's do it. The origin of the Citadel. Burr, 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 burr. Give us some music here.
Dun 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 dun.
origin of
the Citadel. That's kind of like a Mario theme song.
That's exactly Mario.
You know what song's been stuck in my head?
Please tell me.
It's been Teenage Dirtbag by Wheatus.
Why?
Well, I don't really know why. Actually, I do know why. It's because I listened to a Walk Off the Earth cover of them.
Walk Off the Earth is amazing.
They're so good. I was listening to their cover of, I don't know, it's some Ed Sheeran song, I think. It's new Ed Sheeran song.
It's the body one.
And then they do like a No Scrubs like thing in it.
I haven't heard their version. I'm going to have to look this up.
You're going to have to listen to it. It's really good.
If we were like Davos Fingers, then Matt would just like interpolate the actual song right here. We do it live in one take, so sorry. No music for you guys.
Yeah, and I don't have it all hooked up. I could do it, but I'm just kind of lazy.
True.
Yeah, true.
So, here's the origin of the Citadel.
Oh, the origin of the Citadel. Yep. Oh, thank you for handing me your notes, Tana.
You're welcome. Don't cheat. Only read that one page.
All right. This is like a reading?
Yep.
Okay.
This is from the World Book on page 216, I want to say.
Ladies and gentlemen, the origin of the Citadel. The origins of the Citadel are almost as mysterious as those of the High Tower itself. Most credit its founding to the second son of Uther of the High Tower, Prince Paramore the Twisted, a sickly boy born with a withered arm and twisted back. Paramore was bedridden for much of his short life, but had an insatiable curiosity about the world beyond his window. So he turned to wise men, teachers, priests, healers, and singers, along with a certain number of wizards, alchemists, and sorcerers. Mm-hmm. It is said the prince had no greater pleasure in life than listening to these scholars argue with one another.
Yes.
Which is pretty fun to do. Anybody that's ever
been near a contentious debate,
yeah,
by knowledgeable people, it's very exciting.
That's the important part though, is it by knowledgeable people, not by, you know, people just,
yeah, we don't want anybody just things. Yelling bullshit, but like if you can argue your position,
yeah,
convincingly, that's,
if you were
also,
on the forensics team in high school,
right,
you,
the debate team,
might be a person that would love to listen. Paramore. You might be a redneck. Anyway. Paramore would love you.
Exactly.
When Paramore died, his brother King Urgon bequeathed a large tract of land beside the Honeywine to Paramore's pets that they might establish themselves and continue learning and questing after truth. And so they did.
And that's from page 216 of your world book. And that's an insert, so we know that it's important.
Okay.
But that's like basically the meat of what we ever get about the Citadel. We know from what we talked about last time with the High Towers that King Uthor of the High Tower had two sons, Urgon the older, Paramore the younger. And it is Paramore, his son, that he builds this Citadel for, or actually he doesn't build it, the brother builds it. But we were saying, do you remember any other famous King Uthors?
Well, of course, Uther Pendragon.
Right?
Yeah.
And so in the middle, smack dab in the middle of your world book, we have a call out. I mean, there are so many references to Arthurian legends anyway, but here in the middle, we really like, this is Arthurian for realsies. And so his brother Urgon would be Arthur, right?
Yeah.
So King Arthur gives his twisted, sickly little brother a college to hang out in, or, you know.
Or would you say a round table?
Well, he's not a knight, right? So.
Well, yeah, he may not be a knight, but this could be a round table of scholars
and wizards. And yeah, and so it becomes, so the other thing, I tried to get dates on this, and there are people in the fandom that have done really great work on what dates for things are, but yeah. I'm not interested in either researching their work or doing that work myself, so I don't know for sure. But it's a long time ago. King Urgon is in the Dawn Age, the Age of Heroes. Like, he is not the Dawn Age, but he's way back there. And there's no true time telling, but we know that Old Town is the oldest town in Westeros. It's one of the oldest seaports. We talked about the Dawnish,
right,
coming over, setting up camp, continuing on probably to Lannisport, to the Iron Islands. If you guys want more in-depth analysis of this, also drunken analysis of this, check out our last two podcasts and we'll go over it pretty well. But to build on that stuff, so sometime after the Dawnish come, set up their camp at Old Town at Battle Island, and then something happens, some battle we don't know about happens. There's a lot of myths about Hightowers slaying dragons. When we first meet House Hightower, which rules this region, they're already kings in the stories, and they're living in Battle Island, and they build the first Hightower on top of Battle Island, which is that smooth black stone that's got a labyrinth on the inside of it, right?
Yeah, so we don't understand how it got there. Yeah. Really, so.
And Maester Yandel is not examining it close enough. He's saying, oh, this predates anybody's ability to build this stuff.
Oh, well.
But yeah, exactly. Like, oh, I guess it's just a mystery. But like, yes, yes. And we think it is the Dawnish, the Great Empire of the Dawn from Yeeti, which is as far across the map as you can get on Westeros. Great. So sometime in the ancient past, there was a great king, possibly a descendant of the Dawnish, but who knows?
Okay.
Named King Arthur. And he built for his brother a college. Yeah. And that's what the Citadel is. He bequeaths this tract of land along the Honeywine River for all these smarty pantses to set up their roots and argue with each other about lore and history and whatever.
History, learning, magical spells.
We know that the Quill and Tankard,
if
where you
dragons
and I are sitting,
are real and if we should try to control them.
That's right. Where we are sitting in the Quill and Tankard,
yes,
this old place, this rickety old place has been here for 600 years. First question of Stump Dave.
Oh, we're going into Stump Dave.
Just today's Stump Dave is just going to be like a rolling Stump Dave throughout the entire episode.
Oh my God.
We can do a couple of, excuse me, questions in rapid succession if you want to. But first question.
First question.
How old is the Quill and Tankard?
600 years.
Ding, ding, ding.
You just said it was 600 years old. Yeah.
What other structure, what other, I wouldn't know if I would call it a structure. What other famous building that features prominently in the main story is also reputed to be 600 years old?
Well, I would say the Hightower. Or at least the original Hightower, the one that kept burning down and getting rebuilt.
Yeah, we don't have good
time measurements on it.
Yep. When the first stones, when it's not a wooden structure, it was a wooden structure and burned down. And
wood and burned,
and then they built it out of stone, and that's where the... But that's not the answer.
This is why we lost. Spoilers.
Oh, we should say what we did.
Trivia.
Yeah, we did. So time out, everyone. The answer was... The phrase of the crossing.
That's what I said. Yay! Stump Day!
Yeah, according to Radio Westeros today, because I was listening to their King Rob episode number one. Also, I love those guys. They're amazing. Go support their Patreon. They're awesome. They were saying that the phrase of the crossing have been toll collectors there for 600 years, which stuck out to me because the Quill and Tankard's been there for 600 years. And so I'm just trying to make a timeline in my head. But I figured I would include that as Stump Dave. Yeah. So we did trivia.
Good question.
We did a trivia thing.
Oh, that's right. So we were invited to partake in a trial by trivia.
Yes, we were.
Which is put on by Trial by Trivia.
The wonderful folks over at Trial by Trivia.
That's right. Tarzan and Felicia and Lola.
I want to say. Yep. So, and they were great.
Yeah, they were awesome. They hosted us. I don't think they knew what they were getting into when they invited us.
We are particular, Dave.
We are, you know.
Some might say we're an acquired taste.
Some might say that, you know, you can invite us somewhere, but you will probably regret it. Because we will just talk and talk and make inappropriate jokes.
And cheers each other.
Cheers each other and jinx.
We drink when we win. We drink when we lose.
We went in originally thinking, you know, so it's a tournament of trivia, and you guys should all go check out the podcast.
They're wonderful. They're doing wonderful work.
Yeah, there's two versions of it, actually. There's the edited version, which Tarzan, I have to give so much credit because we probably made it a nightmare to edit, because we don't do edits. We do everything in one take.
As you guys well know.
So, so there's two versions. There's the 45-minute version.
Yep, that's the quick one.
That's the quick one.
And then there's a nine-hour one.
There's like a 2.5-hour version. Which is most of the stuff that's cut out is Tana and I rambling and being drunk.
Yeah.
And we went in thinking, okay, we're going to drink every time we get a question wrong or we drink. We made a decision and it ended up being basically like, we're just going to do a shot every time we did anything.
Yep. So. And Tarzan was like, not everyone drinks that watches this show. So I have to edit out all your drinks. And I was like, good luck.
Have fun with that.
You poor man. But anyway, it was a great adventure.
Yeah, it was awesome. It was a super fun experience. Yep.
And they're wonderful and we love them.
Yes, absolutely. Big shout outs to Trial by Trivia. Go check them out. Go give them a follow. Give them a like.
Yep.
And, ooh, excuse me.
Now, Dave.
A little cider.
Can you tell me, what is the organizational makeup of the Citadel? We know it's on the honey wine. We know that it's been there since time immemorial. We know it's part of the oldest town. Yeah, but
that's
not organizational.
That's physical.
I'm just trying to set the stage here. Because we can hear the waves lapping outside of the Quill and Tankard, our nice little inn where we're having our ciders, our strong ciders tonight.
We got our dire cat who's our hanging dire out cat with us, is here. That's right. Snacks.
That's right. And so just across the honey wine in the bay is the rest of Old Town. A lot of cobblestone streets. And the entrance to the Citadel has the two giant green sphinxes. One man sphinx, one woman sphinx that right over the arches. Yeah. And when we go in.
Put the man and woman in our mouth.
Yeah. When we go in. All men must drink.
All men must drink.
When we go into the Citadel, who's going to meet us? Who's the lowest man on the totem pole?
It's going to be a novice. It's going to be a keeper.
Ding, ding.
And he's going to say, hey, do you have an appointment? What are you doing?
When he starts earning
some
links.
Can I take your insurance card, please,
what does
and
he
make
become?
A copy of it?
What's the next level up from a novice?
I believe it's an acolyte.
Acolyte, yeah.
Acolyte, yeah.
That'll do.
I was good.
Are you sneaking peeks at my notes?
I am not. This is all from years of gaming.
I love this. All right. So you got novice, you got acolyte. Then what happens to the acolyte? Also, can you name an acolyte? Maybe who's a gender-bending acolyte?
A gender-bending acolyte?
Yeah.
Oh, man, I don't know any transgenders in this.
I think you do.
Do I?
Mm-hmm. You do.
I would say Pike, but he's a maester. Mm.
Any little, like, mini Oberons maybe running around?
Oh, yeah, the sand snake.
Uh-huh.
Laria?
That's right.
Yeah.
Sorella, Alaras.
That's what I said, Alaras.
Yep. Alaras, when we join them in Feast for Crows chapter, or the prologue, they're celebrating. They're right here across from us at the Quill and Tankard tonight, celebrating Alaras's new chain, new link of the chain.
Yeah, what'd she get? What's its pronoun?
He. He prefers he because
he's... Are you
sure? Yes.
It's not like Z or they or them?
Because he is presenting as male. Okay. And so I haven't asked Alaras specifically...
What his pronouns are.
Yes, but I believe that his pronouns are going to be male.
Okay.
And also there was a little hand...
Because you know you can't assume gender in 2017.
That's right. And it's always polite, guys. It's always okay for you to ask someone. If you're not sure, you can politely ask them what pronouns they prefer. And I can assure you that they would be okay with that question. Maybe, I mean, not all humans are the same. But, like, politeness goes a long way.
Yeah.
If you're not sure, you can always just politely ask someone. And if not, then you can use gender-neutral pronouns like their... Right?
Them, they,
your,
yeah, it,
yeah.
Though I don't know, is it not approved?
It is not approved. it is not approved? Definitely not approved.
God damn it!
So
a terrible person. Okay,
Alaras is over there, I just saw him put his hand on Rosie's hand. Did you notice that in the feast chapter?
I didn't see that. Mm-hmm.
I have a little Pate gets his nose out of joint about it. He's Alaras is too sexy by half. And I was like, yeah, he is.
Well, that's because he's actually a... Mm-hmm. Well.
Man. Anyway. And he has that widow's peak. Ugh. Anyway. So they're
there. You can't fall in love with a man.
I could fall in love with Alaras. You don't know me. You don't know my life.
I do know your life. I know you'd rather finger bang Yara.
No, man, not Yara. Asha.
It's the same person.
It's not the same person. Yara in the show is terrible. Is absolutely objectively terrible. Anyway, so what's the next step up from an acolyte.
Well, that would be a maester.
You're right, Dave.
I know I'm right. Come on.
Ding, ding, ding. You're 3 for 3 on this.
That's right. And I'm going to be 4 for 4 because the next one is Grand Maester, son.
No.
Whoa. God, I got so excited.
Cart before the horse.
You shut me down so quickly.
That's
there.
Right. Damn you it. Skipped a step, my friend.
I skipped one?
You did.
What's before
it's unclear because okay. We don't actually have a breakdown. However, there is a step between Grand Maester and the thing that comes below Grand Maester.
Is there only one Grand Maester? Is that the dealio?
Ding, ding, ding.
And then there's like a...
And who does the Grand Maester serve?
The realm, of course.
True. Actually, that's very true.
Yeah.
But in particular...
The king?
The king! The Grand Maester serves the king. Yes, that's right. So... So it seems like the path forward for Maester, once you earn your chain, is to either get shipped out to a lord or a house, you know, you get assigned to a place, or...
It's like a Mormon, you're like a Mormon, you get assigned a duty and you have to go convert
That's
people.
That's right. So you have to go, you know...
Two by two, we're going door to door, because God bong, loves Mormons and he bong. Wants some more. Okay.
One of the best shows ever made.
Mm. Really good, right?
Also, Lin-Manuel was robbed. He almost got an EGOT last night. The Oscars were last night, you guys. We're not going to get into it, but he was robbed.
Do you see the La La Land moon
Can I tell
thing?
You that
moon
I shut it thing? Off when La La Land reputedly won? I was so mad at the Oscars, I shut off the goddamn TV and I went to bed. And I missed all the drama that unfolded afterward. Like,
I was watching Walking Dead and then Talking Dead. And then as soon as Talking Dead ended, I switched over to the Oscars.
And you
it was
saw just the one awesome
one
part.
The one awesome part of the Oscars.
God damn it.
That's what you get.
You know, Charlize Theron said my name. Because there was a movie in the international movie category or some foreign movie category called Tana. T-A-N-N-A. And so there's an audio clip out there, which, why didn't I record this? Why didn't I put it on my phone? You know how I am about my audio clips.
It's time to Google that shit.
And it was Charlize saying, and the winner is Tana. And I'm like, just, that's my text tone forever. Like, that just needs to be my thing, Charlize. Why don't I have that? So,
oh, God.
Yeah, it was kind of a big fail for me last
that's
night.
That's amazing.
I didn't record it. I went to bed before the big reveal. Anyway. So, let's see. Do you know what step you're missing? There's a maester.
Archmaester?
That's right. Ding, ding, ding,
yes!
Ding, 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 ding,
that's
ding,
right,
ding,
son.
Ding.
Put that in my pocket. Let's
Dave,
go.
I'm giving you a 98% on that right
Why
here.
Why only 98%?
Because you did skip Archmaester and went straight to Grandmaester.
Yeah. Well, I was premature. It happens
I know.
Sometimes.
That's why you get
I mean,
a 98.
It's a... Oh.
You need some room to improve.
All right. You know what? In my world, a 98 is an A+ anyway, so I'm good.
All right, here are some questions you may not know the answer to.
Uh-oh.
This is actually a trick question because nobody knows the answer. How many Archmaesters are there?
17.
Maybe.
And a half.
We don't know. We have no idea. There's no definitive answer.
Why would you ask me that question? Because why would you even tell me that it was a trick question to begin with? Why didn't you just wait to
I'm
see
not
how...
I'm trying to set you up to fail. I'm trying to set you up to succeed.
But... You should have waited to see what kind of answer I gave.
I'm not going to not write trick questions, but I'm going to try to give you a heads up when there is a trick question.
You shouldn't have done that. It would have been more fun if you just were like, trick question, nobody knows.
What identifies an Archmaester?
Ooh.
There are three things associated with an Archmaester. What are those three things?
He's got at least 7 links.
Oh, well, actually, maybe. Who knows? But that's not one of them.
Oh, damn it.
Yeah. I assume they have, you know,
a full chain.
I think you have to have a full chain, but as for the regulations,
as for
we
the
are
regulations.
In the dark.
Okay.
Yeah. But they have three things. Each Archmaester has three things.
They have their own subject that they are the Archmaester of.
Correct.
Okay, but I don't know how they identify that as them, but okay. They wear
the blank and blank and blank.
They wear a scepter. And crown and scarlet robe of blood.
Oh, you're on the right track. Yes. I mean, just for the cadence, only for the cadence, uh-oh. Not for any of the
not
answers.
For any of my answers.
Zero
damn
of those
it.
Answers were right. Each maester, each archmaester holds the ring and rod and mask of their particular specialty.
A scepter is a rod.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, I got one.
Half point, 0.5.
I'll take half credit.
Okay, all there's right. a half point there. The ring and rod and mask of that particular element. So the ring and rod and mask of yellow gold or of tin or of pewter, etc. Or
Valyrian steel.
Correct.
Who's the Valyrian steel archmaester?
Can I answer?
Yeah. I'm asking you a question.
Marwyn the Mage.
Is he really?
Ding, 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 ding.
Uh-oh.
And the menagerie hates the mastiff. Oh. That's one of the quotes from, I think Leo Tyrell says it. But
interesting.
It could be. Yeah. But so.
So do you think, I hate to interject, but these things just come to my mind. Do you think he helped Euron get his entire suit, suit of.
Definitely not.
Valyrian steel armor?
I do not think they know each other. They may in the future meet each other. I think their paths are going to intersect, but I don't think they have anything to do with each other at this point in the story.
That's probably a good thing.
Mm-hmm. Because, oh my god, the Crow's Eye is a bad guy. Okay, the Archmaesters meet in secret. The group of senior members, all of the guys that have the ring and rod and mask of their corresponding element, and they are the governing body of the Citadel. And every once in a while, we're not sure how the rules work. This governing group has secret keys that unlock secret vaults, and they meet together behind closed doors in a meeting that is called a what?
Quorum.
Oh, very good answer, but incorrect.
Do I get another guess? Okay. A harem.
Boom, boom, boom. What if the answer is yes? Do you think that they were like, Citadel members of the harem, welcome. I bring this meeting to order.
Yep. Yep, that is exactly what I think.
It is a conclave. Not a harem.
I was close.
Were you?
I mean, you could... Okay, fine.
One of the only things we know that the conclave meets to do is select a new Grand Maester.
But I thought the king selects a new Grand Maester. Doesn't the king fire Grand Maester Pycelle and then...
Great point. It wasn't the king that fired Grand Maester Pycelle. It was...
The hand of the king.
Cersei?
It was Tyrion.
He throws him in the black cells. He throws Pycelle in the black cells.
Yeah.
But then they dust him off. And I think at some point, Tywin has to intercede because the conclave has met and they have picked a new Grand Maester, which I won't punish you with asking you, who is the Grand Maester that the conclave picks to replace Pycelle, Dave? This is Big Bobby Baratheon. I just have to ask Big Bobby Baratheon, who's going to be the new Grand Maester?
Marwyn.
It is a guy that I did not expect for you to know. Archmaester, no, not Theobald. That's a different guy. His last name is, it's on one of my sheets here. His last name is Tyrell, or it used to be. It's Gorman, I think. Archmaester Gorman.
So what's the deal with Qyburn then? I mean, he's an excommunicated maester, right?
Yeah, he was thrown out for studying, essentially for torturing people, and is how it sounds to me. And studying
necromancy or whatever, yeah.
And him and Marwyn actually got along, or at least it seems like they got along. They had an affinity for the esoteric. They, you know, studied ghosts and the occult and magic and what reanimates dead bodies after they've been poisoned by...
He's got the magic in him. Every track he touched just turns it into gold.
Yeah. I wish we had a soundtrack. Like, I wish that now the music would swell, you know? It'd be a perfect moment.
I've got the magic in me. Every track that touched it. That's all.
I can't even beatbox. You don't.
I have guitar behind me.
Yeah, but
the only thing that would come out of it right now would be no scrubs or teenage dirtbag. So.
And Susie the dire cat would run away.
Run as fast as possible because that's exactly how good I am. So good, even the cats run.
So we know that the conclave meets but in secret, okay. And I'm sure that they have this whole, like, they wear their ring and rod and mask of their corresponding elements. I'm sure there's, like, a whole ritual to it.
Yeah. They probably, like, have sex with the same girl. Yeah. Like, pass her around.
Lots of candles.
Like, Illuminati.
Pentecostal
or...
stars yeah, and yeah, shit. Yeah, yeah, we've seen this. We know what this is.
Thanks, Dan Brown.
Yeah. And the Grand Maester advises the king, which you had mentioned, and the Grand Maester sits in on the king's small council. So these are all very important things. We know because Pycelle's little bitch that he was sort of sending information back to the Citadel that was maybe a little bit tattly. Like he tended, we know because of Pycelle that these maesters, the Grand Maester is a political post. It's yeah, a political appointment. The new Grand Maester, what I want to make clear to the audience is that the new Grand Maester who's probably coming in, because remember, Pycelle was murdered at the very end of Dance of Dragons, right? In yeah, the epilogue chapter, Varys and his little, you know, and Kevin goes up to Pycelle's chambers and Pycelle has been murdered and Varys is there with his little mute children talking about how awesome fake Aegon is going to be, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So there's that whole scene. Well, with Pycelle dead, we know that they've already chosen a new Grand Maester who were probably going to meet in the Winds of Winter. And this guy is named Archmaester Gorman or something close to that, but he is a Tyrell by birth. And
it's an interesting choice.
It is a very specific choice, right? Because we have this power structure. What we've been talking about for the past three episodes is Old Town, House Hightower, the Dawnish, and that sort of strife that they've had with Targaryens and with dragon lords.
Yeah.
They, Old Town, under House Hightower, which prioritizes trade and see, you know, like, it's bad for business. War is bad for business. Yeah, that's sort
bullshit.
Of their...
War, yeah. War is good.
Yeah, that's their, but, like... Yeah. That's their, I don't know, philosophy. Yeah.
Yeah.
But their liege lord is House Tyrell over in Highgarden. So Highgarden protects Old Town and House Hightower from all landlocked threats.
And if you're still in the book, our good queen mother is still a Tyrell.
That's right. And Mace Tyrell is the hand of the king, right? Yeah.
So it seems like there's maybe even a political plot to shift the power from the Lannisters
who
took it, right? The Lannisters took it from the Baratheons, really. And it's now kind of shifting to House Tyrell.
That's right. And we see that the Old Town Citadel guys who are in close cahoots both with Highgarden and mostly with House Hightower, because they've been propped up. Remember, they were created by forebears, Uthor of the Hightower.
Yeah.
And so these guys are all in lockstep. And so the next Grand Maester that advises the king is going to be a Tyrell. So where do you think the loyalties, where do you think the advice, where do you think the urging the king is going to be?
Blood is blood.
That's right. And so this is an important point. There's one more guy in that we know of a political position.
Okay.
In the organizational chart of the Citadel. Do you know what it is? I'll give you a clue. Sam tries to talk to him.
He's the librarian.
Yeah. But there's a word for him that is not librarian.
Oh.
Bookkeeper. Seneschal, good answer.
I was
going to
say, it starts with a C.
S.
Seneschal, yeah. That thing.
The Seneschal is the guy that Sam goes to talk to when Sam first gets to the town. The Seneschal is chosen at random. There's a new one every year, and the Seneschal governs. It's picked from one of the Archmaesters, and he governs the day-to-day mundanity of running the Citadel.
That's the guy in the show who we meet who's awesome, who's
actually
in the books, right? Who
yeah,
has the
yep,
glasses and he
I don't think
he
it
says,
is an
like,
archmaester, but
tell me your story or whatever, and he goes, oh, that's not true. It's the book says this, and Sam
that's
goes,
that's the guy.
Well,
then
you're
he
wrong.
Walks up and tries to talk to him.
Yeah.
I think that the Seneschal is the guy that Sam is trying to get to.
Yeah.
And the guy outside, because in the book it's actually a novice,
like an,
a guy that's
like
a 50-year-old. Yeah, and he's not even an acolyte. Like, he's been at this 50 years and he's never even earned a single link, so he's totally a little bitch about it. So, like, I think that that's who it is. But basically, Sam is trying to get to the Seneschal and is stopped by a novice. manning the desk. So, Dave, bonus Tana. Questions. Or this goes out.
Yeah. The winner is Tana.
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 Oh, Charlize. Oh, say my name.
Say my name, say my name. You're acting kind of shady. Ain't calling me baby. Why don't say my name?
Yeah. This is a question for our listeners that are very knowledgeable. Felicia, so I'm looking at me. You, girl. If you don't get this, then you can take that gray rats versus gray mice answer and stick it in the honey wine. All right?
Ooh, that's...
Yeah.
Those are some fighting words, Tana.
Question, Dave. Who is currently the seneschal? It is, I'll accept either who it is supposed to be or who it actually is. There's a clue there.
Well, it's not Marwyn. We know that. Marwyn. It's not Pycelle. We know that. Let's think of that. It's not this gore man kind of dude.
Nope, not him either.
I'm going to go.
It's weird. It's almost like you didn't do your homework.
No, I don't ever do my homework. I'm not in school no more. I don't got to do no homeworks. All right?
Last guess. Final answer.
George.
Nope. Archmaester Theobald. He took over.
You said his name earlier. I should have known that.
He took over for David, Walgrave.
Deductive reasoning is shit.
Because Archmaester Walgrave, who Pate works for, is senile. And has probably Alzheimer's or something and pees himself and cries a lot. And
poor guy.
Yeah, he can't be trusted with anything. And that's why Pate is able to get this key or whatever it is that the that Jake and Hagar wants. And then he bites the Jake and Hagar, gives Pate that gold coin.
So he can get the Maidenhead.
And he bites it and it poisons him and he dies. And then at the end of the book, Pate shows up alive further along the timeline. And so we believe...
Think it's Jake and Hagar.
Yeah, who stole Pate's face. That's right. And now he's chummy with face. Sam. Yep. I have a clip about it.
Would you like to play the clip?
We
can play the clip. Let's play the clip.
Let's play a clip. We're going to be a little bit clip heavy here, guys. I think that's what's going to happen here. So forgive me. We're going to go probably a little bit long today.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Well, there's just so much to cover, you know what I mean?
We are about 42 minutes in. So, and we're probably not even halfway there, are we?
We're not.
We might have to make this a part dos.
So this is Sam and Alarast, and they're talking to each other. This is going to give you a little background on the,
The Isle of Ravens.
The Citadel.
They did not need a boat to reach the Isle of Ravens. A weathered wooden drawbridge linked it to the eastern bank. The Ravenry is the oldest building at the Citadel, Alarast told him. As they crossed over the slow-flowing waters of the Honeywine. In the Age of Heroes, it was supposedly the stronghold of a pirate lord who sat here robbing ships as they came down the river. Moss and creeping vines covered the walls, Sam saw, and ravens walked its battlements in place of archers. The drawbridge had not been raised in living memory. It was cool and dim inside the castle walls. An ancient weirwood filled the yard, as it had since those stones had first been raised. The carved face on its trunk was grown over by the same purple moss that hung heavy from the tree's pale limbs. Half of the branches seemed dead, but elsewhere a few red leaves still rustled, and it was there the ravens liked to perch. The tree was full of them. And there were more in the arch windows overhead around the yard. The ground was speckled by their droppings. As they crossed the yard, one flapped overhead, and he heard the others quacking to each other. Archmaester Walgrave has his chambers in the West Tower, below the White Rookery, Alaris told him. The White Ravens and the Black Ones quarrel like Dornishmen and Marchers, so they keep them apart. Will Archmaester Walgrave understand what I'm telling him? Wondered Sam. You said his wits were prone to wander. He has good days and bad ones, said Alaris. But it is not Walgrave you're going to see. He opened the door to the north tower and began to climb. Sam clambered up the steps behind him. There were flutterings and mutterings from above, and here and there an angry scream, as the ravens complained of being woken. At the top of the steps, a pale blonde youth, about Sam's age, sat outside a door of oak and iron.
So that's our little clip. I think I played that for us earlier in this little trio series.
Yeah.
But I feel like it's so good to orient us in one of the only scenes in the main series where we're in Old Town and where we get the lay of the land. It's so valuable. We've got a huge ancient weirwood.
Uh-huh.
We have a raven. It's alive with ravens, yep, that are watching Sam and Alaris. Yep. We've got Walgrave, and it's after this when Sam goes up to the tower. He's going to meet Marwyn. I've got a clip about Marwyn. I want us to talk about him. He's interesting and an outlier when it comes to maesters.
Yeah.
But they, like,
he's got glass candle.
He has it. Here we go, man.
We're doing it.
Yep.
We're going to do it live.
Can I just press play?
Yeah, just play it.
All right, we're
in. He knew about the glass candles, though he'd never seen one burn. They were the worst kept secret of the Citadel. It was said that they had been brought to Old Town from Valeria 1,000 years before the Doom. He had heard there were four. One was green and three were black, and all were tall and twisted.
So they're all tall and twisted, like a sword or a spear, right? Like,
yeah.
So they're tall and twisted, they're glass candles, they're going to be sharp.
What's the deal with one being green three being black?
Although, green and black, Tyrion's eyes. Mm. Also, green and black, the fight of the greens and blacks. Like, George is doing something deliberate with color here, and it's beyond me and my abilities to figure out what it is, but I can at least recognize that it's a thing.
Okay.
You know, so we've got one green and three black.
Yep.
One of them is lit in Marwyn's chambers, but I don't think it ever specifies whether it's a green candle or a black candle. But it sort of... Excuse me, I'm going to burp.
Go for it.
When you're in a tavern...
Let it out.
When you're in a tavern like this old... You know, it happens.
I'm surprised we haven't heard Bear and the Maiden Fair break already in the background.
Yep. Rosie, another round. Another round tonight. Let's have another round tonight.
But no fighting.
So, let's see. So that was...
All men must drink.
All men must drink. Pound the table, pound the table. You really do look like Bobby Baratheon. It's uncanny.
Yeah?
Yeah. I'm loving it.
I'll try out for the prequels.
I am loving it, dude.
I'll send...
You're going to have to practice with your Warhammer.
We should send HBO a...
clip
like
of
a,
us.
Just a video of me. No, not even a clip of us, just a video, like a video audition of me running around with a Warhammer going...
Your foam swords.
Lyanna!
Kirsten already... So my girlfriend already thinks that I'm the world's greatest nerd, or biggest nerd, not greatest, because that assumes that she would be impressed by it. She already thinks I'm the most, like, insufferable nerd out there, and was like, yeah, what's that thing that you do, you know, with Dave, like, you're LARPing or whatever, and I was like, we do a podcast.
Come on, Kristen.
We don't LARP. What is this?
Oh, but don't
outrage.
Don't hate on LARPers. I have kind of wanted to try it.
I think it would be so fun. I want to be a costumer. I've already talked to you about this.
You want to be a cosplayer?
Costumer. I would be really great at sculpting the things that people wear.
I feel like, though, if you made it, I would be like 10 million times heavier because you would sculpt it out of cement.
Not true. I would sculpt it out of foam, and I would be able to do finishes on it that make it look like burnished metal and badassery. And
you,
like,
are an artist. This is something that you could
do. I have sculpting tools. I already know how to sculpt foam. I know how to finish it. Like, I know about my registration marks.
I hope you know
marks.
How to finish.
This is why Kirsten thinks I'm the worst nerd. Okay, one more clip. We're going to do a clip-heavy show.
All right.
This one is going to be... I'm going to set this guy up for you guys. This one is Marwyn the Mage. So, same chapter. Okay. Sam, you know, is talking to Alaras.
I apologize for sniffling so much.
Are you sick?
I don't know. My nose is just...
It's allergy season in Florida.
It's fucking it's always allergy season in
Florida. It isn't. Now, everyone, like, cursing.
It's like 90% humidity out and 80 degrees
but, like,
now.
But, like, you're stuffy and you're sneezy. It's definitely allergy season here. So, anyway, this one is going to be Marwyn the Mage. Okay, we're running a little after. It's about a minute 15 or so.
All right, bring it.
And it describes him. I want you, Dave, to pay attention to the description of this guy.
All right.
Okay, because like Felicia was saying, the gray rats are like annoying little gray rats. Okay, she didn't say that, but she did. That sound is Dave's beard rubbing against his pop filter. Okay, we've been at this tavern a little while. Here's more of the mage, guys.
Oh, that shot, those two shots to me.
Get in here, Slayer. Growl the man in the doorway. And you, Sphinx, now. Sam, said Alaris, this is Archmeister Marwyn. Marwyn wore a chain of many metals around his bull's neck. Save for that, he looked more like a duckside thug than a maester. His head was too big for his body. And the way it thrust forward from his shoulders, together with that slab of jaw, made him look as if he were about to tear off someone's head. Though short and squat, he was heavy in the chest and shoulders, with a round, rock-hard ale belly, straining at the laces of the leather jerkin he wore in place of robes. Bristly white hair sprouted from his ears and nostrils, his brow beetled. His nose had been broken more than once, and sour leaf had stained his teeth a mottled red. He had the biggest hands that Sam had ever seen. When Sam hesitated, one of those hands grabbed him by the arm and yanked him through the door. The room beyond was large and round.
Yeah. Well, here we are. So, what did you notice about Marwyn the Mage?
Well, first off, he doesn't look like a maester, right? He's this... big, burly fighter dude with large hands. He's got white hair, and he's got, like, this, I don't know, like, red...
Sour leaf
all over his mouth.
Dude, what is red and white?
A zebra.
No, that's black and white and red all over.
Oh,
that's a sunburned zebra.
Oh, God.
I have a joke for you.
Newspaper.
What's black and white and red all over?
Newspaper.
Yeah, no, that's true. I have a joke for you. What do you call a masturbating cow?
A masturbating cow.
Beef stroganoff.
I'm gonna go kill myself.
This is some strong cider, guys. This is cheers.
Cheers. All men must drink.
All men must drink. Oh, I can understand the appeal of this place. The old clanking Dragon Inn.
The Quill and Tankard, the Bill and Lankard.
So yeah, so he's got. I think
you can't confuse me. Even though I'm drunk and I'm rubbing my beard on my pop filter, you're trying to pull shit over my eyes.
I tried to just sneak that one in, and you weren't having it.
No.
Yeah.
You can't do that to me.
All right. So, listen.
I may be stumpable.
Stumpable. Right? Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I've got it together.
You're like a cut down tree.
That's right.
Stumpable.
Stumpable. That's right. That's right.
Oh, where are we?
Marwyn. Sour leaf.
Yeah. So
white
he's
hair,
like a fighter.
Big dude.
White and red. I feel like this white and red visual stuff, you're going to have to stop rubbing
your face. It feels
good. This is why you and Susie the dire cat.
This is why I can't have nice things.
No, you guys are connected. She's your were animal.
She is. Where is she?
Yeah. Because, you know, you're doing the thing where your cat,
like,
you know,
rubs
cats, yeah, that's what you're
head
doing.
Head on stuff, yeah.
So Marwyn is white and red, like the old gods, right?
Okay.
Don't you think
where you're going with this.
So a weirwood tree is white and red.
Yeah, they're white and they have that sappy, bleedy-looking
And
red.
He is, so of all the guys, Leo Tyrell says something like, the menagerie hates the mastiff. And, you know, Marwyn is the mastiff.
He's clearly this giant mastiff guy. And,
yep.
Yeah.
And we know from Qyburn that he's kind of an outsider, right? He spent something like 8 years in the Free Cities. Marwyn is the one that taught Miramar's door. Here's an interesting connection. So follow this little loop. Marwyn spends 8 years studying in the Free Cities and also traveling to Ashai by the Shadow. He keeps company with whores and sorcerers, wizards, and everybody. Like, he... you know, he'll talk to anyone. He wants to learn anything, whatever.
Yeah.
In before the story ever starts, he meets Miramar's door and teaches her blood magic. Then he goes back to the Free Cities. Years pass. Khal Drogo's Khalasar takes over her city, and she uses the blood magic that she learns, Miramar's door learns, from Marwyn the Mage back in Game of Thrones.
No.
So George has been playing with this character. He's had this guy in mind since he created the series 1,360 years ago.
Wait,
when he started writing it.
So you're saying
yeah.
that Marwyn is the reason that Khal Drogo comes back to life as like the zombie person?
Ding. Ding, ding, ding. And further, he provides the knowledge through Miramar's door that Dany uses, right, that she adapts to hatch her dragons.
Oh my god.
So in a very roundabout way, but in a way that we can trace, Marwyn the Mage, that we've just heard about and met for the first time on page at the very end of Feast for Crows, has sort of been responsible for hatching dragons. I mean, I know it's not his stuff, but like...
Oh, sorry.
That sounded like it had a taste.
It tasted like cider, like strong cider. But this is an amazing point because he is basically responsible for the birth of dragons, if you think about it.
Yep.
And if you make that connection, then you have to also jump to the fact that the Menagerie hates the Mastiff because...
They hate him.
The Citadel don't want no dragons.
And they have this Valyrian steel link probably from, like, bygone days. Like, they think that the age of glass candles, the age of the occult is behind them, that now it's an age of science. But when Dany hatches her dragons, the glass candles are able to be lit again. Magic comes back into the world. The alchemists are able to make more wildfire.
That's right.
The universe is cyclical. Like, we're at the
Melisandre goes through that whole thing where... She's in her bathtub and she says, I don't need these powders anymore.
That's right.
You know, I forget who she's talking to. Is it John? Where John asks her a question and she makes some comment like, I had these powders before to help trick people, but now my magic is stronger. Yep. Yeah.
You're right.
I know I'm right.
Dave.
I'm stumpable, but all right.
Big Bobby Dave.
You can call
What's your Baratheon name?
Oh. It has to be Laughing Drunk.
Mmm.
Okay.
Dave the Laughing Drunk.
Dave the Laughing Drunk.
But you're not. Yeah. The Bellowing.
The
no.
Bellow. Ooh.
Dave the. Because you have like the chocolate rain.
I do.
We'll work on it. I have a quote for
the
you.
The Bellowing
from
Captain.
George. George has said, people, this is from The Spoke Martin. And he was talking about this scene where Dany is in the desert and she hatches her dragons.
Okay.
And he said the whole point, people are like, oh, well, how does magic work? Like, what was this scene? We've talked about it in the past, and here's what he said. Quote, the whole point of the Dany scene where she hatches dragons is that she makes the magic up as she goes along. She's someone who really might do anything. I wanted magic in his universe to be something barely under control and half instinctive. And I think that that's very important to what we're talking about. If you can just, because there are some sci-fi and fantasy worlds where it's like,
magic
you follow,
science.
Yeah, you yeah. follow the recipe, you do what it calls for and you get a result.
Yeah.
And that's not the case here.
That's, you know, what's funny about it is that that's not really magic.
Right.
That's science,
yep.
right? You have a recipe, and if it's repeatable, that's the scientific theory,
so,
right?
Yeah.
A plus B equals C.
But instead of chemistry, you get like a magical reaction and, I don't know, necromancy or some shit. But this is like Dany acts on the knowledge that she gets from Miramar's door. Only life can pay for life.
Yeah.
And she kind of like freewheels it.
Yeah.
And she makes this pyre for Drogo. And ends up hatching her dragons, and she, you know, uses Miramar's door as a human sacrifice, which ties into all of, like, the blood sacrifice stuff. So I thought that was very important. So put that in your little memory banks, my friends and listeners.
So if that's the way that magic works, Half
instinctive, he said.
How does Melisandre bring John back?
See, that's outside of our scope today, Dave.
Oh, you mean because it's in the show? Is that because you don't like the show, Tana? Huh?
No, we're talking about the Citadel, and that happens far away from the Citadel.
Okay, fine.
Fair enough.
I'll let you have that one this time.
So moving onward, so we had our whole maester thing. A maester is sent off to a lord's house. In Westeros, if you don't get a maester, you don't count for shit. So if you want to be somebody, you got to have a maester.
If you don't have a maester...
Yep.
If you have a maester, you might be a noble.
You might be a nobody.
If you ain't got a maester... You might be a redneck.
And now, here's what we need to know about a maester's chain, Dave. Tell me everything that you know about a maester's chain.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. The maester's chain is formed of links, and the links each symbolize a different skill set. Each metal represents something different. Valyrian steel is one thing. Iron is another. Steel is another. Gold, silver, tin, etc., etc. Once you form enough links in your chain, you are awesome.
And considered a maester.
A maester.
Something I found out today while researching, or not today, but in researching.
I want everyone to know I did that all from memory. Not that that was that hard of a thing. But
that was nice.
Yeah.
The other patrons in the Quill and Tankard were very impressed with you.
You know, I've been told before that I have a nice voice.
Yeah, I think these other guys up at the bar are going to buy us another round.
Oh, so yeah, yeah.
We're going to be able to stay here a little while. Maester Lewin sighed, quote, I can teach you history, healing, herb lore. I can teach you speech of ravens and how to build a castle and the way a sailor steers his ships by the stars. I can teach you to measure the days and mark the seasons. And at the Citadel in Old Town, they can teach you 1,000 things more. But Bran... No man can teach you magic. Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones.
Which is true. Well, until he meets Bloodraven.
But is Bloodraven really teaching him magic?
Yes.
So then our whole thing about magic being instinctual and random is out the window. That's it. It's gone. Done. I just disproved your entire point, Tana. We're done. We can end.
In this sentence, in this snippet, God, man, having a drinking podcast is hard because it's hard to stay on topic.
People, listen.
Yes.
There are so many people out there telling you,
yeah,
you know, go make a thing. Chris Hardwick's sentence, go make a thing. Mm-hmm. Fucking Kevin Smith says the same thing. Oh, anyone can make a podcast. But I will tell you this. If you want to stay on topic, don't drink. Because it doesn't work for us. You know what? It's a lie. It may work for you. It doesn't work for us.
Fair point. All men must drink.
All men must drink.
All right. Rosie, another round.
Rosie. I have another a golden dragon.
Another round tonight.
It's so hard. I have a golden dragon. I mean,
don't bite it. Don't bite it or you'll die of poison. Okay. I have a quote about the Maester's chain. Do you want to listen to it?
Let's listen.
And I also
have clips here.
I want you to pay attention because there's going to be a little Stump Dave after about spoiler Dave. About what the links are. So you
Some
might want to
get questions right and others die.
I love that song so much. Okay, here we go. No, that's not the one. I have so many things. Okay, here we go. No, I got it.
Okay,
we're
it?
Good.
You ready?
We're good. We're ready.
Okay.
I'll set it up. Nope, I have to set this up.
What?
So John is talking. It's way back, and Sam.
How far back?
A little far.
Do we have to go into our way back machine?
We do.
Everyone climb aboard the Wayback Machine. Dave and Tana, go!
Tana!
Way back! What is wrong with us?
We are now arrived at the moment when Jon is about to be made a man of the Night's Watch.
Ooh.
He goes from being
a bar mitzvah.
That's right. Him and Gren and Pip and like the whole crew are about to become men of the Night's Watch. But Sam, who has been suffering a lot of bullying, especially at, what's his name? The guy that's the master at arms there. He's beating him up. Alistair Thorne.
Yes.
Alistair Thorne.
That's what happens when you get drunk.
People. Is bullying Sam, and he won't let him graduate. And so,
but he does, doesn't he? Because he decides he wants to go do his words with John in front of the weirwood.
Mm-hmm. And so this is in order to get Sam to graduate.
Yeah.
John goes over Alistair Thorne's head and goes straight to Maester Aemon. And so this is a really great scene between John and Maester Aemon. And this is what John, this is how John convinces him to make a play to let Sam graduate.
That a maester's collar is made of chain to remind him that he is sworn to serve, John said, remembering. I asked why each link was a different metal. A silver chain would look much finer with his grey robes, I said. Maester Lewin laughed. A maester forges his chain with study, he told me. The different metals are each a different kind of learning. Gold for the study of money and accounts, silver for healing, iron for warcraft. And he said there were other meanings as well. The color is supposed to remind a maester of the realm he serves. Isn't that so? Lords are gold and knights steel, but two links can't make a chain. You also need silver and iron and lead, tin and copper and bronze and all the rest. And those are farmers and smiths and merchants and the like. A chain needs all sorts of metals, and a land needs all sorts of people.
Isn't that so great? That's just like, so he goes up to Maester Aemon and he makes this impassioned speech. And he talks about the Maester's Collar, and he says it takes all these different people to make a kingdom.
Yeah.
And also, Randall Tarly, arguably the fiercest general in all of Westeros, wasn't able to make Sam a warrior. What makes you think Alistair Thorne's going to be any better?
Yeah.
And if you let him abuse this guy into, you know, beat him into the ground, we're going to miss out on, like, a really talented, you know...
Smart thinker, yeah, person, yeah.
A smart guy.
Not and everyone can be an athlete. Mm-hmm. I mean, look at me. All right?
Dodgeball. You're a dodgeball champion.
It's kickball.
Kickball.
And I'm not
damn
a champion
it
yet. How did you screw that up? You played on my team, Tana.
Cider is a hell of a drug, Dave. All men must drink. Excuse me, moi.
Next time, just let it fly in the mic.
So we've got, we have John there telling us. So the way, this is why this episode was so hard.
You can kind of tell that John, you already know that John is the makers of a good leader.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, yeah, so what if he can't fight? We need someone to fucking man the crows and someone who's going to make the battle plans.
He's not
shit.
Even a man of the Night's Watch yet. He could, like, peace out and go home.
He hasn't even read his Haftorah
That's
yet.
That's it.
All right?
Yeah.
That's part of being a bar mitzvah. You have to read
shalom.
Shit. Shalom. God, Jesus.
Damn it.
Tana.
Baruch atai chadana.
L'chaim. Those are the words of the Night's Watch.
Yeah.
I heard you say them. Baruch atai Adonai, shall serve the realm until my watch has ended. Amen. Targaryen is the master here.
Maester.
Oh, God damn it. Rosie, don't bring us anymore.
So, can you name a few of the metals that make up a maester's chain, Dave?
Gold for silver, for money. Silver.
Yeah.
We've got iron.
Hold on, I need to be making a note of this.
Yeah. Give me them points, girl.
So just name them. Or do you want to just name them, or do you want to name them and say what their use is?
Oh, no, let's just name them.
Okay, let's do that. Okay, let's do that.
Okay, ready?
Go ahead. Start from the beginning.
Gold.
Got it.
Silver.
Got
iron.
It.
Bronze.
Got it.
Tin.
Got it.
Steel.
Got it.
Stone.
What other thing? What other steel is there?
Valyrian steel.
Correct.
Is there a stone link?
There isn't that I know of. So the ones that I know of, so you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You got 7 out of, like, I don't know, possibly 12.
Oh, there's
possibly
more?
13.
Is it glass? Is there a glass link?
There are gems. Grandmaster Pycelle is described to have gems in his But a lot of this is never specified, guys. So there's been a lot of research on my end and not a lot of results, but we're going to try to synthesize it.
Okay. We're making shit up.
Yeah, we're making
it
up.
You're making shit up again, Arnold.
Do you know what the silver link is for, Dave?
The silver link is for...
I have another clip about it.
Battle. Knights and shit. Oh.
Nope. Iron.
I know the gold link is for money, because yeah, we just heard that.
That's right. It is.
I know. We just heard that. I was paying attention to the clip.
Don't be a dick about it. Here we go.
Okay, you're right.
Silver link, Maester's chain. Do you guys know what it's for? You're going to find out.
Dun, 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 though it was not something talked about beyond the walls of the Citadel. All the world knew that a Maester forged his silver link when he had learned the art of healing. But the world preferred to forget that men who knew how to heal also knew how to kill.
Bum, bum, bum.
Uh-oh.
So if you know how to heal someone, you know how to poison them.
The silver link is an assassin.
It's actually supposed to be like medicine, but you know, like medicine can also kill you. So they know
Yeah, I guess that makes sense, because in order to know how to heal from a specific poison, you have to know the specific poison.
Which brings me into a different thing. Uh-oh. When Lewin was talking about learning herb lore, when he says, yeah, does he mean...
Herbology?
Yeah, does he mean the silver link? Is that medicine? Or is he? Is there like a separate...
There's a chain made of moss. A link.
Is there... Well, bronze will tarnish. Like, it'll turn green. But if you're a maester, you're probably going to polish it or something.
Yeah. You wouldn't let that shit oxidize.
So there's a whole bunch of things that I don't know what
this
it's for.
This ain't no Statue of Liberty. All right, dog?
To the best of my knowledge, we have silver, tin, copper, yellow gold, red gold, black iron, regular iron, lead, bronze, Valyrian steel or possibly pale steel, electrum. I could not identify that in the text, but I got it off the Wikipedia. So I don't know if electrum is a thing. I don't remember it from the text.
Song of Ice and Fire Wiki, or?
I got it off of just regular Wikipedia.
Okay.
Gems, because Grandmaster Pycelle has gemstones in his, but it doesn't embellish any more than that. Platinum, pewter, and brass.
Oh, platinum. What is black iron for?
Black iron is for Ravencraft, and is Maester Walgrave, the guy that has Alzheimer's right now. So he has the ring and rod and mask of black iron, and black iron is for Ravencraft. Regular iron is for Warcraft.
Yeah.
You said earlier yellow gold.
It's for money.
Money and accounting. Red gold, I don't know what it's for. I couldn't find out. Copper is for history. And I think Archmaester Periston is the history
guy. Yeah,
Peregrine
is a falcon, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It is. Silver is healing, potions, poison, medicine. I don't know what tin is. I don't know what lead is. I think regular steel is for smithing, but again, I can't corroborate that. I'm just giving you guys my best information based on what I could find and also what Wiki had.
You're making shit up again, Tana.
Electrum might be astrology. I don't know.
Okay.
But if
Do they
I...
have stars and shit?
I don't remember them
mentioning stars or anything.
Maester Lewin said, I can teach you history, which is copper.
Yeah.
Healing, which is silver. Herb lore, which tells me that's probably not silver. It's probably something else. So tin, I don't know. It could be, I don't know what herb lore would be. Bronze, I don't know. I can teach you the speech of ravens, which is black iron. How to build a castle, which means probably architecture. What would architecture be? Stone? But you can't make a link out of stone.
Says who?
Marble? Because it'll break. It's too fragile, Dave.
I walk on tile every single day, and I'm 280 pounds.
But you don't have to pull it over your head. What if you walk into a wall? What if someone hits you with a
sword?
Bitch,
if you a maester, you live in that chain, son.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, what if it breaks?
Yeah, okay, fair enough.
So, you know, we've got
breaks,
architecture.
You clearly didn't get the link for chain making.
So there's going to be architecture. The way a sailor steers his ship by the stars. Your cat has passed out with her hand over her face. It's really cute.
Oh, she was passed out and she had her paw over her eyes. Like, so god damn, these idiots
she are does still look, she looks like a throw rug, like a little miniature throw rug. So basically, there are a lot of chains, and those are the ones that I know what they do. Those are the ones that have been mentioned. Lewin says you can learn all of these things, the days that mark the seasons. What would you call that? Time telling? Calendar math?
That could be astrology. I mean,
yeah.
Because if you think about it, time and calendars were all based off of the stars and the sun and the rotation. The stars,
In the firmament.
In the firmament.
That's a word we don't use much anymore.
What is that?
Firmament. The firmament. The stars in the firmament.
Is this like Pluto's in retrograde or something?
Well, like you, it was a way of thinking about the stars in the sky. That you had some celestial firmament. Yeah. Yeah. Cider. Okay. Only one maester in 100 forges a Valyrian steel link. Lewin did forge his. But he was totally bummed out because he couldn't get a glass candle to light and there wasn't any magic.
Until now.
Yeah, so he had to tell Bran no one can teach you magic.
Only one in how many? 100?
Yeah.
Oh.
And
we don't know how many maesters there are in the Citadel.
We don't.
Okay, so that number could actually be quite significant.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
The number that I have, brass, pewter, platinum, gems, electrum, pale steel, Valyrian steel, bronze, lead, iron, black iron, red gold, yellow gold, copper, tin, and silver... That's the exhausted list of things that I know to be true as Maester's Link. Stump Dave, can you forge more than one link of the same metal?
No.
According to George.
No. You can.
You can. According to George, Gurm says it's possible to have many links of the same metal, which would signify expertise. This was according to the wiki, and I did not independently corroborate that information.
Interesting.
But the wiki says that's what George said.
So, if you were really good at math,
you'd have a lot of gold.
So, I would assume then that if you had the ring and rod and mask of something, you would have multiple links.
Exactly. Isn't in the show they have like the many, many. This sort of like unlocked a mystery for me. Because I'm like, if you earn your one link, you're only going to have like a choker, right? Like, all you're ever going to have.
Well, oh, the links could maybe be a necklace, but large, like,
come on.
But yeah, you're right. Grandmaster Pycelle wraps the chain around his neck a couple times. Yeah,
I'm hoping for Winds of Winter that we get a more complete picture. It doesn't have to be exhaustive, but I'm just like passingly interested, maybe more than that, in how the Citadel organizes itself and as a center of knowledge. Now we're getting to the meaty stuff.
The meaty stuff.
Yeah, because in the Citadel, I need you to read something. I took a here it is. So. Why is the Citadel going to be important for the rest of the book? Because, Dave...
They're the center of knowledge.
And they don't want dragons in the world, right? Like, Marwyn... Yeah,
dragons signify magic, and they're all about science, not magic, bitches.
Bingo bongo dingo dongo.
Yeah, for shingo for shango, maningo badango.
The big question going in is, we've got... So, who all... Let's set the stage. Let's set the stage right now.
All right, let's build it.
Okay. You and I are in the...
Quill and Tankard.
We're in the Quill and Tankard. Right across the Honeywine here, in the major port at Old Town. Okay. In a couple of days' time, what we don't know is that the Iron Fleet, led by Euron Crozeye and his fleet of warships, is going to come sailing in with their magic and whatever.
And an armor suit of Valyrian
steel. That's right. And sacrifices to the Drowned God, and it's going to be chaos.
It's going to be bad. It's going to be a bad time.
What we also know is Obara Sand, way back when we first meet Doran in Feast of Crows, wants to sack Old Town just to fucking do it. Like, she just wanted to take the town to do it. So we have...
Bitches, I did it.
And we're right on sort of the Dornish border. You know, when you're looking at your maps, you know that that's where we sort of are. We're at the ankle of Dorne.
Okay.
And sort of where the Dornish mountains meet the Reach, but we're the, like, waterway in, but we're a fortified city.
Yep, yep.
And we have the little watchtower, the High Tower on its little island. And we have the High Tower. Yep, we have the High Tower fleet protecting us. And we're out here in the water somewhere at our little tavern, which is so fun. Alaras is outside shooting some arrows.
Yeah, and we highly recommend that you guys come take a trip to the Quill and Tankard.
Don't slip on the cobblestones. Don't bite the gold pieces. Yep. Leave Rosie alone. You'll be fine. But Sam just got here on Cinnamon Wind, and he met Alaras, and Marwyn the mage just left, on the Cinnamon Wind. That's where we are. That's how many people are sort of interested in this one area in the main story, right? Okay. Jake and Hagar is here.
Pate, he's got a face on.
What the fuck, Dave, is a faceless man doing in Old Town?
I mean, besides killing people?
Why did he need to kill this nobody? This kid couldn't even earn a single link to become an acolyte. He's been a novice for, 5 years? Kid's a piece of shit. Nobody wants this guy.
Whoa.
I'm sorry,
Whoa.
I know. Look, that's harsh. I'm sorry.
Some people have learning disabilities.
I'm sorry.
It takes
that was
them a
harsh.
While,
You're
all
right? You're right. That was all harsh. Right? That was a little too...
Yeah.
That was a little
but
tough.
Come on. 5 years, you can't even get a goddamn math link?
Come on. You can't figure out a way to pass one test?
Come on, man. Cheat a little. Fuck.
So, here we go. Pate.
All right. So, Pate dies.
But we know that he has access to Walgrave, who is an archmaester and has the special key.
Yep.
He has the ring and rod and mask of black iron.
That's right.
What does that mean?
Master of Ravencraft.
That's right. And so Pate mostly spends his day cleaning up bird shit and cleaning up Walgrave shit after he shits his pants. So he's got a special key that unlocks doors in the Citadel. Here.
What if Jake and Hagar wants access to the Citadel's ravens?
Why?
Send the white ravens out to signify winter.
Well, yeah, but...
I mean, it's already happened.
That's the weakest plot I ever heard. Okay, so listen, we've been at
Do you have a theory?
No, we've been at the tavern for a while, and I'm going to have to take a TV timeout.
Okay.
Because we're going to have to just regroup after we use the bathroom.
Use the bio... PP. All right.
Okay.
BRB. And we're back from peeing in
the
sink here at the Quill and Tankard.
They do not have adequate facilities here.
No.
You would
bullshit.
Think for a 600-year-old leaning old building,
I had to go.
It would be better.
I went in the back and peed
in a bush.
In a bush.
Yeah, I knew it.
Wasn't my hair.
Crab apples, right? Because that's what Alaras was shooting.
Yeah, for real.
But anyway, we're back.
We're back now.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. And Dave, I have a thing that I want you to read, okay? This is a, it's a passage. It's from the most recent book. You might know it as Dance with Dragons. And I want you to pick up here, he was less hopeful concerning Septon Barth. To set the stage, Tyrion Lannister is on the pole boat, and he's been tasked with writing down everything that he knows to be true about dragons. And he's done quite a bit of research on dragons, it turns out. The big mystery is, how the fuck do you hatch a dragon? How do you defeat a dragon? What is it about? Are they male or female? Like, how do they lay eggs? Like, what is there? Anything about dragons, nobody knows shit anymore. Tyrion, write some stuff down.
Well, we think that they were created from blood magic and sex with humans. But anyway.
Yeah.
He was less hopeful concerning Septon Barth's dragons, worms, and wyverns, their unnatural history. Barth had been Blacksmith's son who rose up to be King's Hand during the reign of Jaehaerys the Conciliator. His enemies have always claimed he was more sorcerer than Septon. Baelor the Blessed had ordered all of Barth's writings destroyed when he came to the Iron Throne.
That motherfucker.
10 years ago, Tyrion had read a fragment of unnatural history that had eluded the Blessed... that had eluded the Blessed Baelor, but he had doubted that any of Barth's work has found its way across the Narrow Sea.
Which is where Tyrion is right now.
And of course, there was even less chance of his coming on the fragment.
Fragmentary?
No, I was just making sure that I got coming right.
Very important.
There was even less chance of him coming on the fragmentary, anonymous blood-soaked tome, sometimes called Blood and Fire, and sometimes the Death of Dragons, the only surviving copy of which was supposedly hidden away in a locked vault beneath the Citadel.
Ding, ding, ding. Dave, would you just read that last sentence, which I think is the crux of today's episode, please?
And of course, there was even less chance of his coming. Oh, not that part.
Why does anyone listen to our podcast? I don't know.
Coming on the fragmentary, anonymous, blood-soaked tome, sometimes called Blood and Fire, and sometimes The Death of Dragons.
Who wrote this? I think it's going to be Gildane. The surviving
copy of which supposedly was hidden away in a locked vault beneath the Citadel.
It's got to be Gildane, right? Because Gildane...
Why, you don't think it's Barth?
No, because Septon Barth existed during Jaehaerys' great reign. And he was pretty... I mean, he was reviled after with the descendants of Jaehaerys. But during Jaehaerys' reign, he was like the boss bitch. Like, people loved him and his books were plentiful. So... I wonder if it's Gildane, because Gildane is kind of George's alter ego in the Maesterdom.
But it's so interesting. And it's locked, supposedly,
What's the title? What's the title of it?
Blood and Fire, and sometimes The Death of Dragons.
So this is the thing. Like, there is something about the way dragons exist, or existed, that the Citadel is against. And they've locked up knowledge. They burned all the knowledge, right? Baelor the Blessed was... tied to the faith. We have established in our previous podcast that the faith is tied to the Citadel, is tied to House Hightower.
Which is tied to hating dragons.
Yep. So it's so like inverted dragon has three heads. The hater of dragons.
So do you think that Jaqen H'ghar is here to get into this locked vault?
So,
to get these hidden secret tests?
Great point, Dave. Because what does Walgrave, so if he's going to take over, Jaqen H'ghar, if he's going to take over Pate, why the fuck would he even bother with this waste of space? Pate has been an acolyte, no, excuse me, a novice, not even an acolyte.
For 5 years.
For how many fucking years? So many years.
Can't even forge a link.
Not one single link.
Not one single link, but he has access to keys, Tana.
Why?
He is the keymaster.
That's what I'm saying.
Are you the gatekeeper? Because I'm the keymaster.
So he's got an archmaester, right? Like, this piece of shit has
an archmaester. Name that movie!
I don't know.
Ghostbusters, come on.
Hey-o!
You know the original? Keymaster? Gate? No?
No. I don't know what it... I don't know well enough.
Maybe I'm wrong.
Quote it.
Alright. Sorry. Continue. So he kills Pate.
Yeah.
He takes Pate's body. He's now got access to all these places.
To Walgrave, who has... insanity. What is it?
Dementia.
Dementia.
But he's the he's the librarian.
But he's not. Somebody, Theobald, had to take over for Walgrave. Because Walgrave can't do that job.
Right.
So Walgrave is just peeing his own pants and being insane. And
maybe Pate didn't know that. Maybe Jaqen H'ghar didn't know that at the time. So Pate was like his way in and now he's going to realize it.
Maybe, but I think Pate is a perfect cover for him.
Okay.
Because Pate has access to that iron key, that secret key that unlocks that Archmaester's, of which Walgrave is one.
So why would the Faceless Men want this knowledge?
Great point. Okay. Before we had our break for pee-pee time, we talked about who was converging on Old Town. Who was converging on Old Town?
Euron Greyjoy is headed this way.
And he said that he paid... No. In his rage, he had a dragon's egg. But
he claims to have a dragon's egg.
And he threw it into the sea in one of his rages.
Okay.
The working fan theory.
Why would you throw it into the sea?
Is that, remember the dwarf of High Heart?
Yes.
She had a vision. Do you remember what her vision was when it came to the faceless man on a bridge?
There was a one-eyed crow on the shoulder, and he pushes Balon off of the bridge, right?
Yes, yeah. She sees the death of Balon Greyjoy at a faceless man with a crow on his fucking shoulder.
Well, I mean, that's clearly...
The crow's eye.
Yeah, it's Euron Crow's eye.
So we're seeing, like, a very... Like, this is a specific path. Euron Crow's eye. There's our train.
Yep. Hi, train. Woo-woo.
We can extrapolate that Euron Crow's eye paid a king's ransom. It is so expensive to get a faceless man to kill someone for you. Peter says this.
Peter, early. You said it right. I'm so proud of you.
Peter, I'm working on it. Had said it earlier when Robert Baratheon wants to kill Dany, and he's like, let's hire the faceless men. And Peter was like, no, dude, we can't afford that. Basically, the faceless men are super expensive.
Yeah.
So... If Euron, who had a dragon's egg, threw it into the ocean, right? Basically, he would pay a faceless man to throw Balon into the ocean.
I see.
And essentially, like, there's a nice symbolism for what happened to that dragon's egg, which means, where's that dragon's egg
so
now?
So that means the faceless men have a dragon's egg. But
Dingo
what
dongo.
The what the fudge
so,
pack
so, so follow me on this. If the faceless men have a dragon's egg,
yeah.
wouldn't they send a faceless man to go figure out how the fuck to open a dragon's egg? And where do you think that path would take them?
To the secret locked vaults of
the Citadel. Where Tyrion's like, there are some scrolls that exist behind locked doors about that exist nowhere else in the world about dragons and whatever the title is, the bullshit title, how to hatch dragons or whatever it is.
The death of dragons.
The death of dragons. You need information about dragons. Here's how you get it. You find a patsy who has access to an iron key.
Okay, here's another working theory. Let's assume that maybe they don't have a dragon's egg.
Okay.
But, I mean, it's quite obvious that they know about Dany's dragons.
Yep.
So maybe they're trying to get in to learn how to kill a dragon.
Good, Dave. Good. They don't even need to have to try to hatch a dragon. They just need to know how the fuck to kill some dragons.
That's right.
Because the faceless men, if our working theory of the faceless men pans out, they were the slaves working in the 14 flames. The first faceless man was working in a mine, and it was horrendous, and he had another guy that was, like, worked to the bone that prayed for death, and then the slave owners, like, all of that mythos that Arya's learning is pretty much the slaves of old Valyria and how they rose up against their slave masters. So the faceless men then would be an enemy to any dragon lord, right?
That's right, yeah.
And so maybe Jaqen isn't there to hatch an egg. Maybe he's there to figure out how the fuck to kill some fucking dragons.
Yeah. And maybe even if they do have a dragon egg, maybe they want to know how to kill a dragon so that they can be the ones with the dragon.
Because dragons are force multipliers. Dragons are like, you know,
dragons
they're
take
nuclear
your power.
Bombs here.
Yeah, that's right. Dragon takes your power from being, you know, North Korea to the United States. That's a bad one.
Yeah,
but
we're never going to get the...
But you understand what I'm saying. Like you said, it's a force multiplier. So if you got yourself a motherfucking dragon, you a motherfucking badass.
And so the knowledge is power thing is true. There are things that only exist in Old Town. And that knowledge is locked away. And we have people, Sam, Jaqen H'ghar, Alaras the Sphinx... people that are there that are trying to unlock this knowledge. At the same time, when winds of winter. God almighty.
God damn, Rosie, this is strong.
When they show up, the Iron Men are about to lay siege and, I don't know, magical storm to Old Town. Shit's about to get real in the middle
of
Old Town.
Down.
Now,
meet me at the mall.
Yeah.
Meet me at the town. It's going down. Meet me at the Citadel. It's going down.
I have, so this is underwhelming, but I have one final clip.
Okay.
And I just want to remind people. So I think that there's more for us to talk about here, Dave.
I think we're going to have to break it to a part two, but let's leave our listeners with a little bit of a cliffhanging taste in their mouths.
It's not a cliffhanger so much as it's like, I want you guys to remember this important thing that happened.
I want to give them, like, you know, just enough satisfaction that they're wanting more.
Just enough.
Just the tip. Just give them the tip. This episode, I've just decided right this moment.
It's not just the tip episode.
This episode is being called just the tip, comma, of the Citadel.
There was a lot of shaft. It's the shaft of the Citadel.
Well,
I feel like the tip maybe is the more exciting part. Maybe that's like the fun stuff we'll talk about
next episode is the tip of the Citadel?
Yeah, I feel like this is all the shaft.
Can we call this episode?
Because this is like the base builder.
The shaft of the Citadel? And next part two will be called the tip? I mean...
Let's not delve in. Here we go. Sam is going to talk to us about what dragon books he has brought with him to Old Town.
He had to get down on his knees to gather up the books he dropped. I should not have brought so many, he told himself as he brushed the dirt of Colloquo Voltaire's Jade Compendium, a thick volume of tales and legends from the East that Maester Aemon had commanded him to find. The book appeared on damage, Maester Tomax's Dragonkin being a history of House Trigarion from exile to apotheosis with a consideration of the life and death of dragons, had not been so fortunate. It had come open as it fell, and a few pages had gotten muddy, including one with a rather nice picture of Balerion the Black Dread, done in colored inks. Sam cursed himself for a clumsy oaf as he smoothed the pages down and brushed them off. Chilio's presence always flustered him and gave rise to, risings.
I think that's a perfect clip for us to end on. Holy shit.
I mean, we're talking about penises. He's getting on his knees. Guys. And then at the end, he's got himself a rising. So, ladies and gentlemen.
No. I just have to say before we sign up.
You got some more stuff?
Pay attention to these two books. Tomix's Dragon King being a description of the Targaryen dragons from Apex to Apotheosis. Okay, with a consideration. Basically, like, there is an in-depth. These are the books that Sam brought with him and Maester Aemon to Old Town. Mm-hmm. And so these are the books that are going to possibly be something that we study in the next iteration. And George has been very specific about planting them here. But he shrouds it in this, like, secret boner episode where he, like, accidentally got some mud on the page. And I'm thinking, did he smudge something important? Is there going, like, we're going to see these books again.
Is there something missing?
We know that the Colloquo Voltaire Jade Compendium is the book that has the Azor Ahai mythos in it. And it also tells us everything we need to know about Yeeti and the Dawn civilization, the, like, Dawnish. But Sam is specifically bringing these two books and dozens of others with him to Old Town.
Do you think it's because they potentially only exist at the Night's Watch because it's so old?
Dingo Dongo. And Baelor burned up all the other dragon copies. Books. Yeah. Yep. And now what I would like us to talk about next time is how sad it would be if the Dragon Double X theory isn't real. But I'm having some real conflicting thoughts about it, Dave. And so I want to say...
Are you a little by Dragon X?
I'm a little, like, I don't know, chromosomally depressed.
Oh, no.
Yeah, because... Tana. Because, Dave, if Danny is the only person in the world that can hatch a dragon's egg, we're going to have a really boring story. What about fake Aegon? What about Euron? What about Jon up in the north, who may have a dragon's egg in Winterfell?
Winterfell's crypts, right. If you listen to our Winterfell episode, there's a lot of potential things that are in the crypts of Winterfell.
I can't imagine Danny's going to show up in Winterfell to hatch some eggs.
Yeah, unless there's some incestual love going on between Danny and Jon.
What if, remember Kickball Eric, how he was like the warg gene as a proxy?
Oh, yeah.
If that's it, then is Jon going to be able to hatch an egg? I feel like I'm at a sort of existential crossroads about our Dragon Double X.
Well, I think that's a good place to leave our viewers with.
Please
the
write
shaft.
In. Do you guys think that this is what?
Do you guys even listen to
us?
Are
there going to be dragons
out there?
Does Jon get a dragon, anyone? I thought, yeah, for
Did
sure.
the Faceless Men give Jon a dragon?
Are the Faceless Men trying to hatch a dragon
or kill a dragon? I think those are good questions.
Right? Because there's no proof that they have the egg, but we the fandom, think that...
That they do.
Yeah, because Euron threw his egg into the ocean in a fit of rage or whatever he said. And he
killed Balon in a fit of rage. And
so the symbolism is all there. So that would mean that Arya's Faceless Men have a fucking dragon egg. Can Arya hatch it? She's a chick and has a warg gene. But, like, what if Arya gets a fucking dragon? That doesn't seem right. She has a direwolf. What about Nymeria?
Yeah.
Man, bitches ain't loyal.
Bitches ain't nothing but hoes and tricks. Ladies and gentlemen.
Nerds and neckbeards.
On that note, we're going to leave you with the shaftiest of shaft episodes of the Citadel.
The Citadel
Until
shaft.
Next time when we give you just the tip.
Rosie, another round tonight.
Round for everyone in the Quill and Tankard.
Alaris, over here, buddy.
We'll buy you some shit.
All right. Bye, guys.
See you till next time.